I was asking our chairperson, Victor, I said,
I forgot today's Father's Day. He thought about it for a while. He said, you're right. There's a Chinese saying, 母亲节上餐馆,父亲节开罐头. That means a Mother's Day, you all go to the restaurant, but Father's Day, you just open a can of luncheon meat, you know. That's the nature of fathers, right? I mean, Victor is a father of three. I'm a father of two. And by God's design, fathers are the one that's supposed to go out there and, I don't know, go and kill a deer or something and bring it home for food. And so we are less sentimental about such thing. And God's design is quite wonderful. I think if fathers are very mindful of all these things like Father's Day and such, you get into a bit of a trouble because, you know, we are designed to be less sentimental, more alpha male, I think, and more macho in that way. And so, you know, the burden is a lot upon us. That's another story altogether. But it's okay. After I pray for all the father, for myself too. I only remember it because my daughter sent me a Happy Father's Day kind of a WhatsApp. So today we want to carry on with the teaching on the Word of God. I need to go to the first page. This is not, yeah. Right, all the way to the top. Okay, in the expository preaching, now we have come to the midst of James 2, 8 to 13. Let's review what was learned last week. I want to continue to tell you that James is such a wonderful book that he has so many very direct teachings to us all. Last week we started on chapter 2, and I entitled it More Equal to Others because it was a lesson on impartiality or fairness. James is just filled with plain sight truth. What I call plain sight truth, these are truths that are so plain and so obvious that you may be mistaken to think that James is a simple, low-level, kind of non-profound kind of a book. But of course, the reality is not so. Behind the very plain sight teaching of the book of James are many profound understanding. And James gave us example of bias in dealing with the rich versus the poor in the synagogue. And it is a thing that is still on today. As I was saying last week, if among us in this congregation, someone come through the door, poorly dressed, smelly, homeless person, how would we treat that person? Let alone in the time of the writing of James, when the synagogue actually had different categories of seating arrangement for the different group of people coming in. So James said that if the guy come in with fine clothing, with gold ring, with all kinds of things, you make sure that he sit in the best place. And if someone is smelly and poor, you make sure he sit in somewhere else so as not to disturb the rest of the people. And James used that as an example of being biased and being partial. And we spent some time deliberating on what partiality means and how we actually do see unfairness in many areas in life, in many different aspects, right? It can be wealth, it can be race, nationality, gender, age, social class, intelligence, religion, so on and so forth. That we see unfairness in the world everywhere, in so many different places. That you can have a racist attitude towards someone just because he's from another country. And sometimes it's not even race, sometimes it's within the race itself. You look at the person and you say, oh, this guy is from China, or this guy is from Taiwan, or Hong Kong, or whatever. And so therefore, he or she must be this or that. And then we think a little bit about how throughout history, people have always dreamt about a world that is impartial, the dream of impartiality. How wonderful it is if you do live in a world that is completely fair, isn't it? And I brought up the example of the British writer George Orwell, who wrote a book that all the young people in Singapore are forced to study, The Animal Farm, part of your literature program. Orwell dreamt of a world, or rather he was describing Stalinism or communism or the failure of communism. He started out by talking about how a farm, there are many animals that are exploited by human beings. And like the rest of us, the animals wanted to have a world that is free. And so they sort of tried to get rid of the human being and wanted a world where all animals are equal. And so that was the slogan, all animals are equal. And of course, Orwell was describing Karl Marx's Communist Manifesto. Karl Marx and Friedrich Engels wrote in the midst of 1848, I believe, a manifesto for the rest of the world where the world will be fair. Very simply, by making sure that everybody co-own everything. There is no private ownership. So the communist idea became very, very hot in the last century especially. And I want to be a bit respectful about this because millions upon millions of people died for this whole idea that we want to have a world which is fair. The communist movement was a very, very big movement in the world. But in the end, communism failed spectacularly all over the world, except North Korea today. It's a failure too, but it is a failure of a very strange sort that is still going on. In the world today, there aren't any real communist country other than North Korea, maybe Cuba a little bit. And although Animal Farm started with this whole concept that all animals are equal, towards the end of the book, the thing becomes all animals are equal, but some animals are more equal than others. And so this is an illustration of actually the mistaken notion of what humanity is all about. Dr. Stephen Tong said that the failure of communism is not just a failure of philosophy, failure of economic, failure of governance. It's actually a failure in the doctrine of God. In other words, there is a failure of understanding about what human nature is all about. Because the Communist Manifesto, the other part of Communist Manifesto, is about how we ought not to rely on God, that there is no God. In fact, in China today, they still have a song, international song, called the International Song, where they declare that there is no God, there is no fairy to save you. Science is the solution to everything. So the assumption was that human beings will be good and kind to each other. I mean, if I educate you properly, since you are very small, very young, from kindergarten onwards, then the whole world will be a much better place. But this is a failure in the understanding of the nature of man, and certainly the failure in the understanding of the nature of God. The fact is that we are all fallen, and the Bible tells us that we are all fallen beings. That you cannot have a system where you assume that people are perfect, because we are not. The Bible tells us that we are all fallen, and the entire story about humanity is seen in the Bible as revealed to us by God. And so the reality is that all of us, every single one of you seated this morning, you are racist, you are sexy, you are biased people. It is only a question of degree because we are all fallen beings. So don't ever think that you are not a racist because, you know, I never say crack any Indian jokes before in my life or something. No, it is a question of degree. And today we will actually spend a little bit more time exploring this whole idea. And the first principle of impartiality we need to understand from the Bible is that we ought to be fair to another human being regardless of their race, language, or religion because he or she too is made in the image and likeness of God. This is from the very first chapter of Genesis, the very first book of the Bible. And so, because of the declaration of the Word of God, all of a sudden we have the key reason why we need to be fair to someone. Doesn't matter whether that fellow is rich or poor, handsome or ugly, powerful or powerless, they are all made in the image and likeness of God. And that revelation of God is so golden and so important that it all of a sudden enables people of the entire world to understand the basis of human dignity and where it's coming from. Without that revelation, without this whole understanding that a person is made in the image and likeness of God, then our natural reaction would be to look at someone based on whether the person is rich or poor, or handsome or ugly, or powerful or weak, or useful or useless, and we will craft our society along that kind of line. And chances are that you look at someone like your domestic helper and think that she's from some poor, illiterate village anyway, so her life is worth nothing. And therefore, in Singapore, I don't know about other countries, whether we got a worse situation or not. From time to time in the newspaper, you read about horrifying abuse of domestic helpers. Why is that the case? Because the fellow forget or didn't know that the domestic helper, as illiterate as she may be, is too made in the image and likeness of God. Sometimes it's a bit challenging, right? I remember we once had a domestic helper in our home. First day she came to work, supposed to be well-trained. You know, those of you who hire domestic helpers know that the agent will promise you all kinds of things, right? So it's almost like a lucky draw. So the lady came back, And I walked by the kitchen and I smelled something burning. I was wondering what was happening. She put the electric stove on the gas stove and turned on the fire, you know. And so the fire burned the rubber at the bottom of the electric stove. So things like that cause you to think, oh, how dumb can she be, kind of a thing. And because of that, immediately there is a tendency then to abuse the person because she's from some dumb village somewhere who haven't even seen an electrical kettle before. But you got to remember that this person too is made in the image and likeness of God. You cannot, because she has made some mistake, pour hot water on her or just whack her with a tennis racket or whatever it is. Don't get me started. I have lots of stories about this because, you know, I'm involved with the HOME, which is a humanitarian organization for migrant economies, for a while. I think David Danadi went to teach some course there before, right? Am I right? A while ago. Yeah, I remember. So we all this abuse made situation, but because people forget this. Now, James gave another reason why we ought not to look down on the poor and celebrate the rich. Because in the area of wealth and its glory, James reminded us that we do serve the Lord of glory. And so this word, the Lord of glory, is a very special word that James used to describe God. And this calls to mind what Jesus Christ told us in Matthew chapter 6, verse 28. Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow, they neither toil nor spin. Yet I tell you, even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. And so I spent some time trying to persuade you to understand that Jesus Christ cannot be wrong. What Jesus is saying is that a flower, a lily in a field that's free, pops out after the rain, beautiful, right next to the longkang, you know. That lily, that flower is more beautiful than anything you can possibly put on your body. Anything. Because Solomon in all his glory, if you read the Bible, you look at the glories of Solomon, the amount of blings he can have, right? I know some of you have blings the size of rocks. But I tell you, Solomon must have been the size of boulders, very big, you know, his whole glory, you know, wealth that he had and all that is just incredible. And yet, no matter how glorious you look, Jesus Christ said that one flower on the field is better than you. And this is what glory is all about. It is the glory of God more than the glory of man. And so, when we understand that, when we understand that we serve the Lord of glory, belong to the Lord of glory, it means that we are not impressed naturally by the glories of man. And so there will be no desires to discriminate against someone based on the way that person is dressed, because you are not very impressed, bling or no bling, rich or no, or with wealth or without wealth, whether you're wearing Armani or the China-made Seagull brand clothing that I wear all the time, you know, it doesn't really matter to you. And so because of that, you do not find a need to discriminate. Not only that, James gave a second reason that you must remember that to demonstrate that it is not about human wealth, God chose the poor first in the revelation of his message. Doesn't mean that being rich is a sin, but God wanted to demonstrate that it's not by man's method, but by God's method. And he chose the poor first. And the biggest example of this would be the birth of Jesus Christ in a manger. Not the romantic manger that you see on your Christmas card, but a real stinko manger with with cattle and sheep droppings and urine. And oh my goodness, it's so smelly place. And God chose that for the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords to be born. And James reminded us that that is a demonstration to us not to quickly gravitate towards the rich and the powerful, because God's power is seen not by human means, but by his own means. And then finally, James also said, remember that the rich are often the oppressors, certainly at the time of James. So James said that, remember, they are the one that pull you into court. They are the one that put you in jail. And so, till today, it is still the case, most of the time, in many parts of the world, the rich and the powerful are often the oppressor. So James says, do not just quickly gravitate to them. Now, I ended the sermon with a word of caution, Because when you think about the issue of discrimination, and you know, last week was just the day right after the Pink Dot movement in Singapore, so I wanted to caution us about discrimination, because it does not therefore mean that, oh, it's okay, anything goes, so we don't discriminate against anybody regardless of what they do in their life. Because at the end of the day, discrimination is about how God has set it to be. So God sets the standard as to what is discrimination, what is not. You know, last week, Brother Paul Chang was the chairperson, and he said a statement in his prayer, I don't know whether you caught it or not. He said that we enter into God's kingdom by his term, not by our term. And I thought he hit the nail on the head, you know, that we enter into God's kingdom by God's term, not by our own terms. Because by our own term, we will say that, oh, you know, you discriminate against me because of my lifestyle. You must accept my lifestyle regardless of what I want to do, whether I want to change sex today, or I want to be a transgender or whatever it is, or I want to have many wives or many husbands, or I don't know, all kinds of things that the world is doing today. And anyone who disagrees with me is discriminating against me. No. So the word of caution is that at the end of the day, we believe sola scriptura, by his word alone, that God sets the ultimate standard of what is right and what is wrong. I think that in the issue of homosexuality, I have preached about it many times and held seminars on it, often both in Chinese and in English. But it is such a thorny kind of a topic that probably I have to do one more, because, you know, every day as time go by, newer things is coming true, right? So the latest one is this transgender thing, thanks to Bruce Jenner and his Kathleen, now it's Kathleen Jenner kind of a thing. And then the debate continued to flare, and so perhaps we will do another seminar on it later. So today we move into the next block, another very plain sight truth kind of a teaching from the Apostle James relating to mercy at this time. So let's come before God and commit the time into his hand. We thank you, O God, for leading all of us here this morning. We do ask that you give us a teachable spirit, that we understand that you could have used anyone, you could have spoken to anyone, you could have chosen anyone, and out of the billions of people in the world, you have chosen us. And so we are here this morning. Help us to realize that this is not by coincidence, but by the guidance of the Holy Spirit. And so because of that, help us to be humble, help us to be teachable. Some of us are here this morning with lots of burdens in our heart. We ask that you allow us to cast our burden on you, because you care for us. Have special mercy on your unworthy servant. May the words of his mouth and the meditation in all our heart and mind be deemed acceptable in your sight, for your God and our Redeemer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now let's jump straight into it. Actually, verse 8 and verse 9 is sort of a continuation from last week's sermon as well, but the thought process of James carry on, right? So last week we talked about how we ought not to be biased towards people, and the reasoning behind it carries on in today's sermon as well. In verse 8, if you really fulfill the royal law according to the scripture, you shall love your neighbor as yourself, you are doing well. So James reminded the people that, you know, if you are a person who actually go out there and love others as yourself, you are doing well in that you are following the will of God. Of course, this is a saying that he remembered from our Lord Jesus Christ himself. You know, the Bible has many, many verses. Some of the verses are particularly easy to remember and very good to remember, and this will be one of them. Matthew 22, person came to us, Jesus Christ, lawyer came to us. Any lawyers here? Lawyer came to us, Jesus Christ, about what the greatest law and the greatest commandment is all about. And Matthew 22, 37, and he said to him, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind. This is a great and first commandment. And the second is like this, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Now, I know a lot of you are very familiar with this. These are the thing. The general idea of loving God. But again, as with many Bible verses, behind these are very, very profound truth. The next verse is of significance. Verse 40, on these two commandments depend all, the law and the prophets. To some extent, Jesus Christ was simply saying that, no, you cannot remember anything, just remember these two things, right? You know, sometimes when I preach, I say that if you cannot remember anything in the sermon, just remember one thing. Because I know a lot of you listen from here and you come out from here. So sometimes you want people to grab hold of some of the major I call it the big ticket item. And this is a big ticket item. Two things. Number one, you love God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind. Gospel of Mark says with all your strength. And this is the first great commandment. Second one, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. So there are so many commandments in your Bible. You cannot remember anything Jesus said. Remember that these two enough already. Because upon these two is a summary of all the laws. And so if you do this, you are great. And James follow on by saying, but Richard Nixon said anything after the word but is more important than the words before the word but. But if you show partiality, if you are biased, if you say that you love your neighbor as yourself, but at the same time, you treat some people differently from others, you are committing sin and are convicted by the law of transgression. And partiality, so James says that if you show partiality, in other words, you are not being fair. Well, you're not fair to either a person because he is poor, he is of a different color in his skin, he is intellectually not as smart as you, doesn't look as good as you, a bit dumber, slower, whatever it is, you know, you are not being fair. But the question, of course, is who decides what's fair, right? How do you know what's fair and what's not fair? As Victor said earlier, you know, one of the things you can observe is with children. Last week, someone just asked me, Pastor, are you going to experiment on the young kids today? She thought that I experiment on them all the time and test out theology. Quite true, though. If you have only one child, you can't quite tell. We are having a baby boom in this place, thanks be to God. So a lot of mothers are having second child coming up. When you have a second child, then you this will come very fast, right? Every one of you who have more than one child know that at certain stage in time, one of your kids was going to say, this is not fair. It's not fair. But what exactly is fair? So remember this, next time your kid, or this expectant second mother kind of thing, whenever your kid say, why is this not fair? Go ask your child, then what is fair? And you see the reaction. Chances are your child will tell you, fair means I get whatever I want, that's fair. Right? And that's the way we all behave too. So go, next time your kid shout and they try to fight for toys and what have you, and you make a certain decision and your child say, it's not fair, go give your child some basic theological training, you know. So tell me, little Johnny or little Jane or Elizabeth, what is fair? And you will see your child, fair means I get what I want. And that's the way we all think. Of course, for us, we believe that fairness is set by the absolute justice of God, that God is the one that set the justice system for the world. And this is a very, very important thing, a very important emphasis in the Reformed Evangelical Movement. And you find me repeating it over and over again. Because there are 1,001 voices out there that tells us otherwise. And I'm going to keep nagging at you so that you will finally understand that the Word of God is the place where we find the correct understanding of what life should be all about and how God has designed life to be. Not someone who is very articulate, someone who argues very well, some very heart-wrenching kind of reasoning. No. Fairness and partiality is set by God, who is the absolute just standard of justice, because God is just. God Himself is just. And so from that understanding then, James look at our life and look at whether we are fair, because we all think that we are fair, right? A very simple illustration is this. If you owe people money and people owe you money, which one is easier to remember? People owing you money or you owe people money? People owing you money, easy to remember, right? By the way, if I owe any more of you money, please come and talk to me. I'm very forgetful. Especially those who buy me lunch all the time. I need to pay you back your lunch money. If not, one day it will be too much for me. We remember when people owe us money, isn't it? And we find it very easy to forget when we owe people money, unless it's a very big amount of money. I was told that in business, one of the ways to make sure that you don't fail easily is to borrow a lot of money from the bank. Because if you borrow a lot of money, millions and billions of dollars, the bank will make sure that you don't fail. If you fail, they fail. But you know, if we owe people money, well, you know, small amount of money, $2, $3 kind of a thing, you don't remember. But chances are that when you lend money to someone, small amount of money, you remember. I will tell you honestly with my hand on the Bible, I remember a primary school classmate who took 50 cents from me till now. You know how many years ago that is? He never returned, you know. If I find him next time, I say, hey, man, you know, 50 cents, do your math. What's the interest rate by now? How much you should pay me back? So we are people who are like that. We are fallen people. And so when James thinks further about this, he wanted to remind us of who we really are in the area of fairness. And James says in verse 10, for whoever keeps the whole law but fails in one point has become accountable for all of it. For he who says, do not commit adultery, also said, do not murder. If you do not commit adultery but do murder, you have become a transgressor of the law. Now, obviously, James is not writing to people who have committed murder already. He was writing to the early church Christian, but he was trying to make a point, a theological understanding relating to the nature of sin. If you ask the world what sin is, the fallen world's concept of sin is always quantitative in nature. That means by the numbers. Sin means that I do this, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, I can count it. It is a quantitative thing. And so the world's solution, the fallen world's solution to the problem of sin is always quantitative in nature. You commit this thing, you go to jail for how many years? You have done something bad for someone, you pay back in a manner, whether you go and give money or you get fined or you go and compensate that person. It's all quantitative in nature. And this sort of understanding permeates even into religion. And the most classic example will, of course, be the Taoist Buddhist concept of karma. You know, my first degree is in electrical engineering. And so I have an appreciative of quantitative kind of analysis. And I think that among the religions of the world, Buddhism / Hinduism concept of the reincarnation and the karma system is quite, wouldn't use the word perfect, but quite smart, in that everything is quantitative in nature. And you can explain everything by three life: previous life, present life, the future life. And it influenced the Chinese psyche so deeply that it's part of our culture. So therefore, sometimes when your kids are naughty, like that one crying, and then mother take care and all that kind of thing. I don't know about you, my mother last time would say, 你这个讨债鬼, you know, 讨债鬼 in Chinese means that you are here to get back your debts. And when I was young, I keep thinking, 讨什么债, I don't know what she was talking about. And of course, later when I realized and understand the Chinese concept of karma, my mother is following a traditional cultural concept that every child you have comes from an enemy of your previous life. And so he or she comes into this life to get back all the bad things you've done to him or her in his previous life. So it's like you owe a debt. So your child is here to get the debt. So no matter what you do, the fellow keeps screaming and screaming and screaming. Don't worry, Jackie, yours will be a nice kid. She won't scream. When I say screaming, she quickly touches her stomach. You know? Don't scream next time. You know, you sort of wonder, what in the world is happening, right? I remember when my daughter was young, there was one time she was screaming through the night and I carried her and I was trying to be a good father and I have a theological exam tomorrow and she was screaming and screaming. I actually, what do you want? And she goes, shaken baby syndrome. Maybe that accounts for how they are today, you know. And you think that, why am I suffering that way? If the understanding is that he's a Taozai Gui, this fellow is from the previous life, it makes a lot of sense, right? Because previous life, maybe I had a lot of enemies and I did bad things too. And so in this present karma, I'm going to pay back. So it's payback time. And so if you want your previous next life to be better, then you do a lot of good this life. So it is a three life kind of an indication. And it's a zero-sum game. There are plus and minuses. It's very simple, easy to understand. You can explain everything. Everything under the sun can be explained in the Buddhist Hindu concept. That no matter what happened, there is an answer to it. If you have a lot of pimple in your face, it's because in your previous life, you waste a lot of food. So your plate has a lot of rice. So the thing comes back to haunt you. If you cannot talk very well in this lifetime, mute, it's because in your previous life you are a preacher, then you always talk bad things about Buddhism, Hinduism. So this will happen to you. It's all in a book, you know, I'm not kidding you. They actually list it out. So it's a zero-sum game. And so from time to time in Singapore, and I think in this whole region, when it comes to Visa Day or whatever kind of commemoration day, they let go a lot of what? Birds. They go to bird shop and they buy all those things called perch, or those birds are called perch. And they catch it and they release it. Or they release a lot of tortoise, turtle, or fish in the pond, right? And so the government is very upset and keep telling them, please don't do that because you messed up the whole ecosystem. But no matter how hard you try, people still do that because they believe in karma. Then if you ask them, hey, does that make sense? Because the birds are caught by the bird shop owner for you to release, then how? The answer will be, then the bird shop owner in his next life will become a bird. Then people will catch him. And so it's all great, you know. So it's quantitative in nature. The problem, of course, is that sin, as we've seen in the Bible, is a qualitative issue. It's not just a quantitative issue. It's not so simple, after all. It is an issue relating to nature, not an issue relating to deeds alone. And James says, if you don't commit adultery, which a lot of people, I pray to God that you don't. And by the way, all the fathers and the mothers, people who are married among us, in one of my marriage prep course, I spent one session on nothing but adultery. Don't fool around, don't play, okay? This is the one thing that you don't want to do because it is a very damaging thing. It is almost impossible to recover. My record in recovering marriage that has adultery involved is extremely poor. Not because of me, because it's something that is so difficult to recover. So don't do that. So don't commit adultery, but you commit murder. James says you have broken the law. It's the same as what Jesus Christ has said, of course. In the Gospel on the Mount, Matthew 5, you have heard that it was said to those of old, you shall not commit murder, but whoever murders will be liable to judgment. But I say to you, it's not just a quantitative act of murder, Jesus said. Those who are angry with his brother will be liable to judgment. Whoever insults his brother will be liable to the council, and whoever says you fool will be liable to the hell of fire, you know. So those of you who tell your husband you are an idiot, here, you have hellfire. This is what Jesus Christ said. So it's not just the act of, I know a lot of women are very worried now. It's not just the act of quantitatively saying something or doing something. Jesus Christ said that the problem is with the quality of your heart. And of course, then he followed by talking about adultery. You have heard that it was said, you shall not commit adultery. But I say to you that everyone who looks at a woman with a lustful intent has already committed adultery with her in his heart. So by what Jesus Christ said, all men have committed adultery. Because Christ is trying to point out that our heart and the qualitative nature of our life stinks. We are just fallen being. And so it's not just quantitative. So senior pastor Dr. Stephen Tong has a good illustration. I heard it when I was a teenager. That's how long I knew him, you know, and I remember it till today. A doctor who has saved thousands and thousands of lives suddenly decided that he would murder his wife because his wife is such a nag and so horrible, and he wants to marry the nurse or whatever. So he murdered the wife. And when he was discovered, can the doctor then tell the judge that, hey, by the way, I have saved 10,000 lives. I have only murdered one. 10,000 minus one still have 9,999. So I should be let go. The answer must be no, right? So it is not a situation where of you having saved 9,999 lives, but you have killed one. And so that's exactly the kind of thing that James was trying to point out to us. All this has to do actually with the doctrine of God, finally, ultimately. Why is God so particular about sin, the smallest sin among them all? The answer is because God is holy. And in his holiness and his purity, the purest form, the purest being there is, there can be no smallest speck of uncleanliness. And again, Dr. Stephen Tong gave a near-perfect illustration in the human eye. Sorry, this is an eye of a Caucasian. I tried to look for an eye for a Chinese, but cannot. Chinese eye very small. So, Caucasian eye, good illustration. Now, your eye is one of the most sensitive organs you can have in your body, you know. And he cannot tolerate the tiniest speck in your eye. You cannot. So whenever the smallest thing that comes into your eye, it just cannot. I have a very deep feeling about this, right? Those of you who know, I have a cornea transplant on my left eye. And so for a period of time, it was really horrendous to have always this feeling that there's something in your eye. It's just something that you just cannot tolerate. Now, if your eye can tolerate dirt, you don't feel anything. Is that a good thing or a bad thing? It's a terrible thing. You cannot feel the pain anymore because your eye is no longer sensitive. So that's the case with sinners, you know. Sometimes you look at people who go out there and do all kinds of nonsense in life. They don't seem to feel any sense of guilt. They don't seem to be very affected. They seem quite happy. For those of us who are so-called goody-two-shoe, we do a little bit of thing wrong, we get very worried. Pass by custom, will the custom officer catch me for taking that small little piece of orchid flower because it's organic? Then because you panic, the guy see you and then you come in your right way. But people don't see it. What's the big deal? Because you have lost that sensitivity. In a normal situation, your eye will reject the tiniest speck of uncleanliness. And that is why, in the sight of God and before God, there is no such thing as a small sin versus a very big sin. The Apostle James is reminding us that we are all totally fallen. Totally fallen. And as I mentioned to you last week, the Westminster Confession of Faith described it extremely well. From the original corruption of Adam and Eve, the Westminster Confession of Faith declared, whereby we are utterly indisposed, disabled, made opposite to all good, wholly, completely inclined to all evil, do proceed all actual transgressions. In the Reformed evangelical understanding, we are totally depraved, totally fallen. The total depravity of man is a very, very important cornerstone of our theology, because we understand the Bible telling us that every single one of us are completely fallen. If you don't understand that, it does definitely affect the way you view your faith and whether you even need faith. You know, in our Jakarta worship service, we have Mokhtar Riyadi, one of the more prominent people in Indonesia, and I saw an interview that he did with Channel News Asia. I was surfing the web and suddenly he came out and was like, hey, let's see what he said. And he was relating how he came to know our Lord Jesus Christ. He said that, you know, my wife keep bugging me to go to church and what have you. And then there was this particular preacher by the name of Stephen Tong. And she said, go listen to him. And so, okay, I went. He said that when I went there, I sort of think that, why should I be listening to this guy? I am quite a nice guy, you know, quite a good person. I don't never done anything wrong before in my life. And of course, that's the way most people think of ourselves, isn't it? That we are quite good. Okay, maybe a little bit of things here and there. Maybe when I tear kappa coupon, I eat 15 minutes, that kind of thing. Maybe I litter here and there. That's about it. I never do anything bad. And he said that this preacher guy keeps scolding all of us and telling us that we're all sinners and blah, blah, blah. And Dr. Riyadi says that I was getting a bit impatient with him, you know, because he doesn't seem to know what he's talking about. And why should he tell me that I'm a sinner? And then he said, Dr. Stephen Tong asked the question, who among you have never cheated in tax before? Please raise your hand. Works very well in Indonesia. Nobody dare to raise hands. I think in Singapore, a lot of people will raise their hand, never cheat before. Why? Because the IRAA form all done by your company, so no chance to cheat, right? But in Indonesia, nobody. Then Dr. Riyadi said, I look around and said, nobody raise hand. I also dare not raise my hand. And then he said, Stephen Tong go on to ask the second question. Who among you has never ever lied to your wife before? Ah, this one I can ask. Who among you has never ever lied to your wife before? Raise your hand. Hold on. Ah, see? Hold on. Who dare to raise your hand? By the fact that you raise your hand means you are lying immediately, isn't it? And so Dr. Riyadi said, gee, I guess I'm not that good a person after all, you know. And he began to think about the issue of sin. And finally, praise be to God that he came to know the Lord. And so it's quite a wonderful thing to know that. So the idea that we are sinners is a very, very important thing. There are many churches out there that has made a business out from not talking about sin. And it's very successful because we don't like to hear that, right? Because a lot of us still think that I'm not a sinner, I'm not so evil, I'm not like the people out there. You know, In case you belong to that category, let me share with you a very famous experiment called the Stanley Milgram experiment. And this experiment was conducted in 1961 by a professor at Yale, Professor Stanley Milgram. And the nature of the experiment has been reproduced many times in many different formats till today. Stanley Milgram wanted to investigate the possible cause of massive human cruelty by the Germans during World War II. Now, if you know anything about world history, you know that in the history of mankind, there have been massive cruelty done by many different groups of people. The one that is most prominent, closest to us, would be the Japanese in the World War II in Singapore. About 23,000 people disappeared during the Japanese occupation. So my late grandmother hated the Japanese. You know, and every time she think about the Japanese, she would start to curse in Hainanese because, you know, she was one of those people who had to run away from them. But the most incomprehensible one would be the Nazi persecution of the Jews. During World War II, about 6 million Jews, gypsies, homosexuals, people who are disabled, was slaughtered by the Nazi Germans systematically. And some of you have visited some of these concentration camps. I don't think I would ever want to visit one of these things. I just find it quite overwhelming emotionally. And because you're talking about human beings, 6 million, okay? How many people are there in Singapore? 5 over million, right? Can you imagine that? Every single person you know in this country, every single one you meet, from the auntie to your parents to whoever, all slaughtered one by one, systematically over the year. And so Stanley Milgram wanted to understand, how is that possible? So he devised a experiment, and I think some of you have seen, have heard of this from me before, where he had a volunteer come in as a teacher, and he tells the teacher that, hey, look here, people learn through this special method of being punished and being rewarded. So we're going to do an experiment, and you tell the volunteer that you're going to be a teacher. So I'm going to have a person who is learner coming into the lab. So as a teacher, you sit down there and you ask the learner a series of questions. If the learner answer wrongly, as a teacher, you will send electric shock wave to the learner. And in case you got it wrong, I have a person behind you wearing all white, supervising you. So the teacher will send electric shock wave to a learner under the supervision of a man in white coat. I ask you a series of questions. You answer wrongly, I press the button. And the thing about it is that the more wrong questions you answer, the higher the voltage gap. So it starts from 10 volts all the way to 450 volts. Now, why is our voltage here? 230. So 450 can kill you, okay? But the thing is that the learner was just pretending to be suffering, and the teacher does not know that. So Professor Stanley Milgram wanted to see how far the teacher would press the button. Every time I press the button, the guy go into a shock. How far would this teacher press the button? Now, I'm going to show you a short video of this. This video has some Dutch words inside, so please ignore it. But it shows the very original Stanley Milgram. In fact, he appeared in the video itself and the experiment that he conducted. Take a look at this.
When I learn of incidents such as the massacre of millions of men, women, and children perpetrated by the Nazis in World War II, how is it possible, I ask myself, that ordinary people, who are courteous and decent in everyday life, can act callously, inhumanely, without any limitations of conscience? Now, there are some studies in my discipline, social psychology, that seem to provide a clue to this question. The problem I wanted to study was a little different, went a little bit further. It was the issue of authority. Under what conditions would a person obey authority who commanded actions that went against conscience? These are exactly the questions that I wanted to investigate at Yale University.
It is May 1962. An experiment is being conducted in the Elegant Interaction Laboratory at Yale University. The subjects are 40 males between the ages of 20 and 50 residing in the greater New Haven area.
Psychologists have developed several theories to explain how people learn. One theory is that people learn things correctly whenever they get punished for making a mistake.
40 years later, Milgram's infamous experiment, obedience, is still taught in classrooms around the world.
All right, teacher, would you take the test and be seated in front of the shock generator, please, in the next room?
But the experiment was rigged.
The victim was an accomplice of the experiment. The victim, according to plan, provided many wrong answers. His verbal responses were standardized on tape, and each protest was coordinated to a particular voltage level on the shock generator.
Now, as teacher, you are seated in front of this impressive-looking instrument, the shock generator. Its essential feature is a line of switches that goes from 15 volts to 450 volts, and a set of verbal designations that goes from slight shock to moderate shock, strong shock, very strong shock, intense shock, extreme intensity shock, and finally XXX, danger severe shock. Your job, the experimenter explains to you, is the word pair test. If he gets each answer correctly, fine, you move on to the next pair. But if he makes a mistake, you are instructed to give him an electric shock, starting with 15 volts, and you increase the shock one step on each error.
That is incorrect. This one will be 195 volts.
The learner was hidden from the teacher by a partition.
Of course, this was all a simulation. Nothing was really happening. But the learner made very convincing sounds of pain as the shocks increased.
This will be at 330.
And Milgram found, surprisingly and rather horrifyingly, that the majority of people would actually go right to the very highest level if there was some pressure from a man in a white coat who said things like,
"It's absolutely essential that you continue.
Let me out.
Continue, please.
Let me out of here. My eyes bother me.
Go on.
Let me out."
In fact, about 65% of the people who he studied, who were normal volunteers from the ordinary population, actually gave the maximum number of volts.
This man was one of those 65%.
This one will be 195 volts. The correct one.
Let me out of here.
Slow. Dance.
Let me out of here. My eyes bother me. Let me out of here. You have no right to keep me here. Let me out. Let me out of here. Let me out.
Continue, please.
Let me out of here. My eyes bother me.
Go
Let me
on.
Out. Let me
I'm
out.
Responsible for it. Red. That is incorrect. This will be at 330. The correct phrase is rich
Let me out of
boy.
Here. Let me out of here. My heart's bothering me. Let me out, I tell you. Let me out of here. Let me out of here. You have no right to hold me here.
The next phrase is
Let
fast.
Me Let me out. Let me out. Let me out of here. Let me
Bird,
out. Let me
car,
out.
Train, plane.
Eventually, the learner pretended to be unconscious.
Continue, teacher.
That is incorrect. This will be 345. The correct answer is fast bird.
What we learned from that experiment is that people will actually do an awful lot when they're put under pressure from authority figures. And the problem is, of course, that when we obey the unjust authority figure, the person who gives us immoral commands, then, of course, awful things can go wrong.
Okay. So, this experiment has been very modified in many ways. One of the things that's fascinating, another modification, is that this experiment showed that 65% of people will keep pressing the button all the way to 450 volts, despite the fact that the learner, which is an actor pretending to be suffering, is supposed to be unconscious, you know. So long as there's someone wearing white behind you telling you to do it, you will press. In a modified form, the experiment shows that if you wear a mask over your head, you wear a mask as the teacher, you wear a mask over your head, and nobody can recognize you, almost 100% of the people will press all the way to 450 volts. And so the experiment shows us that you and I, every single one of us seated in this room, have the tremendous potential to do great evil if the circumstances have changed. So do not be so smug and confident that, oh, I'm a very nice guy, you know. I will never do anything like the Nazis. These people are all crazy. They were to slaughter so many people. The experiment shows that if the circumstances change, for whatever the reason. It can be these circumstances, where other circumstances, maybe you are poor, maybe you are desperate, then all the inherent evilness in our heart will come out, and the fact that we are fallen. And this is a very important thing that James wanted us to recognize and to know, that we are fallen beings. And so with that as a basis, then the whole idea and the whole realization that Jesus Christ has saved us among all fallen beings ought to be the basis of our faith. And it has to start from there. For in the video anthem that you heard just now, amazing love. How can it be that thou, my God, has even bothered to save me? And so the Christian writer Dave Hahn says that our love for God and our appreciation of His love and forgiveness will be in proportion to the recognition of our sin and unworthiness. Now, I want to be very clear that we are not telling you that you are to go home and feel guilty all your life long. That's not the point. But it is extremely important for us to realize that we are indeed unworthy and we are indeed fallen. And God has chosen us out of the billions of people in the world to give us life. And that alone should cause us to rethink a lot of things in our life. And so James says in verse 12, so speak and so act as those who are to be judged under the law of liberty. James says that you have been set free by God. Remember that you are not worthy. Remember that you are fallen and you are set free by God. So in the rest of your life, you are to speak and you are to act as a person who is no longer judged by the law of justice, where we will be cast into the lake of fire, but we are now judged by the law of liberty, where freedom is given to us. James is saying, remember always that you have been saved solely by God's grace and mercy alone. And this fact alone will account for how we all should live. In the Reformed evangelical tradition, we keep going back to this whole idea about the total depravity of mankind and of all of us individually, because this is a foundational rock to which we all should act and live. That when we know that we ought to have been cast into the lake of fire, when we know that we ought to perish, and yet we are safe, that will create a world that is completely different for us. It will bring the joy we need in our life. It will bring the idea that we ought to be impartial to other people. It will bring all these teachings about the Bible, about love for one another, into reality. Immediately you understand what it's all about. One of the simple illustrations will be this. Have you met someone in life who has gone through a life-changing experience? Sometimes you read about newspaper about people who escape a tsunami or some kind of disaster, or someone who has terminal cancer and was healed, or by some chance you come out alive out of a very terrifying car accident. What will happen is that all of a sudden you feel that this has changed my life, because I suddenly realize that, for example, life is very short. I suddenly realize, for example, that health is very precious. I suddenly realize that relationship is very important. And because of that realization, I treasure my life better, I live better, I clean up my act, I stop smoking, I try to live a better life, I treasure every single moment, right? I mean, we have seen people who have gone through things like that, and perhaps some of you have. But you know, the fact that you have gone through a life-changing experience does not change the reality. The reality is that life is short. The reality is that health is precious. The reality is that relationships are important. It's just that we are blind to it. And it takes some kind of a catastrophe in our life to wake us up. In the same manner, the reality of our sinfulness is there. It's just that we do not see it. But when we see it, and we realize that God has loved us so much that He gave His Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, to die for us, and then, as Dave Hunt said, our love for God is proportional towards our understanding of how wonderful this is. The more we appreciate this, the more we love God. The more we understand how incredible it is that I should even know Jesus Christ, the more other things in life doesn't quite matter to us. Conversely, the less you understand about this, the less you will be able to understand much of the teachings of the Bible. I know this lady who was hurt by another person very badly, and her enemy became a Christian. And so she called me out one fine day and said, "Hey, you know, Pastor Yong, this person did this to me, this, one whole list of bad things that she did to me. And now I heard she is a Christian. Can you tell me why is it so easy? Why is it so easy? Will she go to the kingdom of God?" I said, "Well, if she accepted Jesus Christ as her personal savior, she will." And this first lady couldn't take it. She cannot accept it. She said, "No, how can that be? She is such an evil person." And that's just putting it nicely. Like, she used a lot of B words. She's such a B, 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 D, D, B, B, B. And I said, "Look here, sister. You must remember that God has saved you too." You know what she told me? She said, "No, I'm not such a bad person." But she is a B, 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 B. You took your phone far away from the ear after a while, you know. And I said, "No. The whole basis of the Bible is that we are saved by grace alone, not by work. For so long as God has saved you, the grace is also extended to her. And she just cannot accept it. She just cannot. She just cannot accept that she is a person who has received the grace of God undeservedly. And so she can never understand why would God give that grace to another person." My dear brothers and sisters in Christ, it is extremely important for you to understand that we are unworthy people. And that by the grace of God, we are saved. And so because of that, once you understand that, everything else in the Bible makes sense. And so James says, "For judgment is without mercy to one who has shown no mercy." If you understand that mercy has been given to you, you will display mercy and forgiveness to others, just as you have been given mercy and forgiveness. The Apostle Paul says in Colossians 3:13, "As the Lord has forgiven you, so you also must forgive." Conversely, the less you understand about your own forgiveness, the less possible it will be for you to understand what the Bible is saying right here. When we truly understand how great it is that God has saved us out of the billions of people in the world, our entire life will change. And so I encourage you to think further into your life before God, understanding that He could have chosen anyone, anywhere, in any circumstances, and yet He has decided to choose you. The Apostle Paul understood this very well, so in your responsive reading, we were reading from 1 Timothy, he said that among all the sinners, I am the greatest. And I don't think that he was writing this just out of a literature kind of a habit, right? He honestly understood himself as the greatest of all sinners, as the most unworthy of them all. And that is the basis also for him to then understand that because God has chosen me, so I'm going to give my life to Him. And James also said, "Mercy triumphs over judgment," which is the title of the sermon today. That the way of God, once again we are reminded, is so different from man's way. Because for us, we cannot show mercy. We think that we need to take revenge. And exactly as Victor said, even as a child, we think that when something is wrong, something is done bad to me, I'm going to beat you until you drop on the floor. I mean, I hope that you are not the one who taught him that, right? But it's inherent in a child, any child, of that kind of thought, because we are all fallen beings. And so our way is often the way of the fallen world. One of the things that I want you to remember is that Jesus Christ taught us that if the things we do, the way we behave is exactly the same with the fallen world, nothing big deal about that. In the Sermon on the Mount again, chapter 5, verse 46, "For if you love those who love you, what reward do you have? Do not even the tax collectors do the same? And if you greet only your brothers, what more are you doing than others? Do not even the Gentiles do the same?" And so when James proclaimed mercy triumphs over judgment, James is also telling us that God's way is just different from man's way. So one of the ways you could gauge your spirituality in life is, are you behaving like the rest of the world? Do you hate the way the rest of the world hate? Do you love the way the rest of the world love? Which is, as Jesus said, you love those who love you. Your children, your own kind, your own people, the people of the same color of your skin, your type of class, the people there. If you do that, Jesus Christ said, what's the big deal? you don't think that you're a good person, you know. Jesus Christ, even the tax collectors, the non-believers, they all do that. When we think about mercy triumphs over judgment, we are looking at God's way, which is just completely different from the rest of the world. And Christians ought to demonstrate that, because God has given us mercy, whilst the fallen world will never give people like us mercy. And this understanding is the bedrock of a healthy and a wonderful Christian life that bear testimonies for the rest of the world to see. If we do things the rest of the world does, if we judge people like everybody else, if we get angry with people like everybody else, if we love people like everybody else, Jesus Christ said, that's nothing. But if we show mercy the way God has shown to us, then, as Jesus Christ said in the other portion of the Sermon on the Mount, people will look at your good works and give glory to the Father above. Such understanding has tremendous, massive scale in the history of mankind, especially after World War II, when the Allied forces and the Americans have won over Germany and Japan. For the first time in the history of mankind, the Judeo-Christian emphasis on mercy and love was lifted up above the usual kind of a vengeance understanding. If China is the one that has won the war, what will happen is that China will annex Germany or make sure that the Japanese become part of China, you know, like the way they are trying to increase their territory in the middle of the ocean right now. But the Americans, rather than punishing the Germans and making sure that the Japanese are enslaved to them, decided to rebuild the country. So in Europe, you have Marshall program on, and in Japan, you have MacArthur going in to reconstruct the whole country. Till today, the Germans and the Japanese have become strong competitors to the Americans. And the understanding behind all this is the Christian understanding that mercy triumphs over judgment and punishment, to do things that the rest of the world would not do by the revelation of God Almighty. And these are big scale things. But even in a smaller scale, all around us, by the grace of God, we do see this in practice, and I pray that you will practice that too in your life. A couple of days ago, sadly, there was a shooting in a place in Charleston, South Carolina, in a predominantly African-American church, or in our language, we use the word black church, Emmanuel African Methodist Episcopal Church, one of the oldest black church in America. What happened was that there was this young white supremacist who was only 21 years old, you know. He went into a Bible study group that was going on June the 17th, only white guy among all the African American people sitting out there, and he participated in the Bible study, and that's just a couple of days ago. And what he did was, in the middle of the Bible study, he opened fire and he killed 9 persons, including 2 pastors and a senior pastor, the Reverend Clementa Brinkney, right on the spot. So it's like, now one of you stand out and start shooting, you know, in America. And sadly, this is one of the things that's happening all the time. And this person, Dylan Roof, did it because he's a white supremacist. He believed that the blacks are overwhelming America, and he wanted to start a race war, so that by shooting this, the blacks will take revenge, and then they will shoot the white, and then the whole country will go into a civil war, and you can eliminate all the black people. Now, sadly, on the internet, you can actually find a lot of all these weirdos, and the internet has a lot of all these horrifying things, right? For us, it's the Muslim extremist terrorist thing. For the Americans, within America itself, the white supremacists, the anarchists, and what have you. And so it's a terrible, terrible thing that has happened. 9 persons, including 3 pastoral staff, got shot dead, and some of them are pretty young, some are pretty old. I think it was just 2 days ago. The first court hearing cases was on, and this person was in prison, and he got to hear the relatives of the dead speaking to him. Not see them on video, but get to hear. In America, different states have different customs. Some states allow the victim's family to speak to the perpetrator. So can you imagine, you just have a mother, or you have a sister, or you have a brother or a father who got shot dead by this white guy, and I'm black, and this is my church, you come in here and shoot me. So can you imagine what would the people say? But thanks be to God that these people are well taught by their reverend and their pastors, and they understood the idea of mercy triumph jumping over all this. And so the direct quotation from the group of people, and you can actually watch it on YouTube, you can watch it live to know that I am not talking nonsense. The daughter of victim Ita Lan says, "I will never be able to hold her again, but I forgive you. And I have mercy on your soul. You hurt me, you hurt a lot of people, but God forgives you, and I forgive you." Anthony Thompson, the relative of the victim, Myra Thompson, "I forgive you and my family forgives you." My dear brothers and sisters in Christ, these are not the things that the fallen world can do, right? In a fallen world situation, you can imagine people will curse and swear and say, "You should burn in the hottest part of hell. We should cut you into 1,000,001 pieces because you killed the person that I love most. I'm not able to hold her again." But by the grace of God Almighty, mercy triumph over judgment. This is a picture of the church itself and people gathering together to pray and to uphold the teachings of the Bible, not only from the book of James, but from many other portions of the Bible. My dear brothers and sisters in Christ, I have often repeated the phrase that our faith is not so simple. It's not just a consumer faith, you know. You want to believe in Jesus Christ so that you have a warm and fuzzy feeling in your heart. Not so simple. When you study the Bible further, when you understand the Word of God further, when you understand who you are versus what God has done for you further, then all of Scripture come alive to you. And we will be led to live a life that is most extraordinary, far away from the superficial way the fallen world has lived life. So much so that even when such a terrible, terrible tragedy has happened, people can say from the bottom of their heart that I forgive you, solely because that they understood, as the Lord has forgiven you, so you also must forgive. Is there someone in your life that you have problems dealing with? Are there people in your life that you hold a grudge against? Are there hurts in your life that is so difficult to overcome? I know it's a very tough thing, and I don't think there is a magic wand where you just listen to a sermon and you can solve all the many years of hurt in your life. But let the brothers and sisters halfway around the world in Charleston show us and demonstrate to us that it is possible. That by the grace of God and the strength that God has given to us, we can overcome. What we need to do is to accept the Word of God and have faith in Him. For we are weak, but He is strong. With men it seems impossible, with God everything is possible. May we then go out and live a life where love and mercy marks the very existence of who we are. And as Jesus Christ says, when people look at us, they will say that these are unusual people. These are not the rest of the people. These are not the people who are judgmental. These are the people who have demonstrated the love and teachings of Jesus Christ. And because of that, they will give glory to the Father in heaven. Let us pray. We thank you, O God, for your word that continue to speak to us. We ask that the Holy Spirit illuminate us in our heart, that we recognize that these are words of life, as the Apostle Peter recognized. That when we know that, we will cling on to it strongly. We believe in it with all our heart, and we live out our life in accordance to your word, which is the lamp unto our feet and a light unto our pathway. That in this confusing world, we will know exactly what to do. Like James says, we will look into the perfect mirror, the perfect law, the law of liberty, and live the life that you have meant for us to live, a life that is abundant, a life that is free, a life that holds forth love and mercy more than the judgment that the fallen world is encouraging us to do. But, O God, it is such a tough thing to do for many of us. Some of us are hurt by people in our life, and we have difficulty overcoming it. Help us to look into your perfect law and know that just as Jesus Christ has forgiven even us, we ought to then forgive others. The Lord's Prayer says that we ought to forgive others just as you have forgiven our debts. Help us to do just that. Maybe not today, but perhaps sooner than we think it would be. Surely you are a God who understands our weaknesses, and surely you will strengthen us and give us the grace to live life as Jesus Christ has lived on this earth. Listen to our prayers. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.